A warm welcome to everyone. Thank you so much for joining us. Good afternoon, good morning, good evening, wherever you are. I'm Neil Brenner. I teach in the sociology department at the University of Chicago. I'm part of the faculty working group that has proposed CEGU, the formation of the Committee on Environment, Geography, and Urbanization. If I could see your faces, I would ask for a show of hands regarding how many people in the room today have been at some of our previous events, but I can't see your faces, so I will just assume that many of you have and that you may already be familiar with the proposal that we've advanced to form CEGU. But in case you're not, in case you're joining us for the first time, a special welcome to you. But basically, the project around CEGU is to develop new capacities for addressing contemporary climate emergencies through research and pedagogy in environmental social science and environmental humanities. And there are a lot of people, obviously, all over the place concerned about such issues, including at the University of Chicago. So a faculty working group got together about a year and a half ago to develop some proposals along these lines. And we came up with this idea for CEGU. We've done a number of events related to these issues in the form of panels and webinars in the last couple of months around issues such as colonialism, empire and environment, energy histories and geographies. And just last week, we did a panel on democracy, environment, and social movements. And this afternoon's event, I think as everyone knows, is on really questions related to the transformation of the non-human world, the histories and geographies of those transformations and their implications, their far-reaching implications for contemporary political, economic, social life, and environmental conditions. So this panel is on animals, territories, and environments. So the project behind CEGU is really to do research and pedagogy around these issues. Our faculty working group strongly believes that we need to radically innovate our approach to such issues in order to be equipped to understand and to impact the proliferating environmental emergencies of our time. So this is really what we're about. And we're looking forward to sort of working together with colleagues and students at the University of Chicago and beyond, hopefully for many years to come. So I just want to thank my colleagues in the faculty working group who have devoted a lot of time and energy to developing this proposal. I especially want to thank Dean Amanda Woodward for her support of our efforts, as well as Master of the Social Sciences Collegiate Division at the University of Chicago, Howard Nussbaum, who's also been a wonderful support. And I want to thank my colleagues on the executive committee of the CEGU Faculty Working Group who have really put a lot of additional time into developing this agenda and organizing the faculty working group, and indeed this events series. So Lisa Wadeen of the Political Science Department, Alan Collada of the Anthropology Department, Frederick Albritton Janssen of the History Department, and Sabina Scheck, who's the Director of the Urban and Environmental Studies Program. I also wanna thank Carlo Diaz, our Program and Communications Coordinator, who's really been a wonderful comrade and supporter in lots of aspects of this project. So I will be co-moderating today's event with my colleague, Victoria Saramago. And I'm just gonna briefly introduce Victoria, and then she will introduce our two brilliant panelists, as well as say a few more words about today's event. So again, welcome to everyone. We're really happy that you're with us and we're looking forward to today's discussion. Victoria Saramago is Assistant Professor of Hispanic and Luso-Brazilian Studies in the Department of Romance Languages and Literatures. And she's also a faculty affiliate and close collaborator in the CEGU Faculty Working Group here at the University of Chicago. Victoria's research covers 20th and 21st century Latin American literature with a focus on Brazil. She works in the intersection of eco-criticism and fiction theory. She's interested in theoretical approaches to the representation of forest and rural areas in Latin America, Luso-Hispanic dialogues, environmental humanities, energy humanities, and other fields. Victoria has recently published a book titled Fictional Environments, Mimesis, Deforestation, and Development in Latin America, that was published recently with Northwestern University Press. And this book explores how novels can help us make sense of environmental change. It investigates the dynamic relationship between fictional images and real places as the lasting representations of forests, rural areas, and deserts in novels clash with collective perceptions of changes such as deforestation and urbanization. So a warm welcome to everyone. Thanks again for being here. And Victoria, over to you.
Thank you so much, Neil, for your words. And thank you all for being here. It is a great pleasure to see you all and to introduce our brilliant panelists for today. So we will start with a presentation by Matthew Gandy. Matthew is professor of cultural and historical geography and a fellow of King's College, University of Cambridge, UK. And he's also currently a fellow at the Hamburg Institute for Advanced Study. Matthew is a cultural, urban, and environmental geographer with particular interests in landscape, infrastructure, and more recently, biodiversity. The historical scope of his work extends from the middle decades of the 19th century to the recent past. His research ranges from aspects of environmental history, including epidemiology, to contemporary intersections between nature and culture, including the visual arts. His book, Concrete and Clay, Reworking Nature in New York City, MIT Press 2002, was winner of the 2003 Spiro Kostov Award. His book, The Fabric of Space, Water, Modernity, and the Urban Imagination, also published by the MIT Press in 2014, was awarded the 2014 AAG Meridian Award for Outstanding Scholarly Work in Geography. And his most recent book, Natura Urbana, Ecological Constellations in Urban Space, published by the MIT Press in 2022, explores urban nature in an international context. From 2013 to 2018, Matthew was co-editor of the International Journal of Urban and Regional Research. Our second speaker today is Mindi Schneider. Mindi is currently assistant professor in development sociology at Wageningen University in the Netherlands. After this year, she will relocate to Brown University's Institute for Environmental Society. Mindi is a development sociologist with specialization in global food politics, agri-food complexes and regimens, political ecology, and historical sociology. She holds a PhD in development sociology from Cornell University, and she also served as a postdoctoral fellow at the Origi Center for Global Studies at the Johns Hopkins University, and as assistant professor of agrarian food and environmental studies at the Institute of Social Studies. Her writings have appeared widely, including in outlets such as Journal of Peasant Studies, Journal of Agrarian Change, and Third World Quarterly, where she has published a number of widely influential interventions. Mindy's current work focuses first on the social and ecological transformations that accompany the industrialization and capitalization of China's agri-food system, particularly the pork sector. Second, she is developing a project around questions of waste and wasting and death and dying. By bringing critical food and agrarian studies, the belly, into conversation with the discard studies and political ecologies of waste, the excremental, her goal is to examine the production and circulation of waste, especially as it relates to value in food and farming systems. Before we begin, please allow me to say a few words about today's event. So the works of Mindy and Matthew invite us to both problematize each one of these individual categories that are part of the title of our panel today, animals, territories, and environments, from multiple angles, as well as of rethinking the numerous ways in which these categories can converge. At first glance, a comparative perspective on the recent scholarship brings to light the diversity of concrete and imaginative frameworks around the poles of the urban and the rural, which of course have enjoyed such an enduring cultural force across centuries. More specifically, Mindy and Matthew invite us to reconsider, in one case, the crucial transformations that large-scale industrial agriculture and livestock production have been imposing on rural areas over the past decades, and in another case, how contemporary cities can be reconceptualized as spaces of surprising biodiversity and as privileged sites for human and non-human entanglements. To put their works together, as this panel proposes to do, means to highlight this spatial reshaping of foundational categories of environmental studies, both in terms of ongoing processes and future possibilities. So we look forward to a rich and thought-provoking conversation on rural industrialization and urban ecologies. I'm going to give you some idea of the format of this panel. So we will start with presentations by Matthew and Mindy, and then Neil and I will hold a conversation with them, a Q&A, and then we'll open for questions from the audience. So if you have any questions or comments, please post them on the Q&A, use the Q&A function to post them. And in the last part of our panel, the last 30 minutes, Neil and I will read them aloud and have a broader conversation with everyone. Okay, so thank you very much. Now I invite Matthew to start his presentation.
Okay, thank you very much for inviting me. HIAS, by the way, is the Hamburg Institute for Advanced Study in Northern Germany, where I'm currently based. I've recently published a book on urban nature, and one of the real challenges was to make sense of this vast and growing literature. And in today's presentation, I want to draw on my working typology of four different approaches to urban ecology that I've used in the introduction to my book. So these four approaches then that I'm going to very briefly mention are systems-based approaches, which are really the dominant approach within the field of conceptualizing urban nature and urban ecology. Secondly, observational paradigms, which actually have a long history to them. Thirdly, urban political ecology, which is a field of work that I've been closely associated with for some time. And then fourthly, what I identify as the ecological pluriverse as a way of conceptualizing the multi-species city and the possible vantage point from which to build a new kind of conceptual synthesis. So to begin then, the systems-based approach, this is often traced back to the Chicago School of Urban Sociology, although in fact they really used metaphors such as plant succession, but this field of work wasn't really about ecology as such. We have to look at other contributions, for example, the so-called Brussels School of Paul Duvigneau, emerging in the 1960s and 1970s, to see a fully worked out systems-based approach to conceptualizing urban nature through the throughput of energy and materials. And other parallel schools, such as the Industrial Metabolism School of Fischer-Kowalski, also developing at a slightly later stage. And in North America, we find following the increased funding of ecological research in the 1980s and 1990s, we see similar elaborated systems-based approaches, for example, the so-called Baltimore School, which actually make reference back, interestingly, to the Chicago School, and parallel bodies of work in a Phoenix-based research team as well. Fundamentally, though, the point I want to quickly make is that the systems-based approach is now the dominant ecological paradigm with links to resilience discourse, landscape urbanism, and other fields, and that much of this literature rests on an emphasis on epistemological unity between the biophysical and social sciences. Now, a different strand of work, which I want to mention, is that of observational paradigms, this second area of work. And this we can very easily trace back actually to the 19th century and growing fascination with the flora of ruins and waste spaces, for example. The flora of the Colosseum being a famous example, mid-19th century example, and also unusual flora and fauna associated with spaces of urban obliteration, bomb sites in London, Berlin, and other cities. Going back to the 19th century again, very briefly, a number of industrial floras prepared in relation to industrial or urbanized sites in Germany, Luxembourg, Switzerland, and elsewhere. So an emerging fascination then with unusual urban ecologies based through various epistemologies of observation with links to particularly botany and natural history. And Berlin, in particular, played a very prominent role in developing these new fields of work, which were also effectively an inversion of nativist preoccupations within plant sociology, conservation biology, and other fields. So the very fact of recording urban flora and fauna unsettled existing typologies and conceptualizations of urban nature. And then more recently, there's been a growing interest in novel ecosystems, new natures, and cosmopolitan ecologies. So additions to the avian flora of London, such as the rose-ringed parakeet, being an example of these new recombinant or novel ecosystems. And I should also mention, falling within the observational paradigm, new public cultures of nature and citizen science that I've been personally very involved with and I find very enjoyable and fascinating. So when I've been working in Berlin, for example, I regularly collect information on insect observations and send them to cartographic projects. And I'm always delighted to see my records included when you check the different grid reference as I'm showing here. And then the third body of work is that of urban political ecology. And I just want to mention a few elements here because it's an area of work that many people here already are very familiar with. But I want to stress that urban political ecology develops in many ways a diametrically opposed variant of analysis to the systems-based approach, drawing on the Frankfurt School, neo-Marxian interpretations, inspiration from aspects of urban and environmental history, but at a ground level in terms of empirical foci, focusing on questions of racism, inadequate housing, toxic environments, and a host of other issues that had been systematically marginalized within the systems-based approach. But this field of work itself now is under intense scrutiny, and there are a range of emerging challenges, which I think are extremely interesting. One is the lack of engagement between urban political ecology and developments within the ecological sciences themselves. Where does science lie as a vibrant field within urban political ecology? Also, extended conceptions of agency, subjectivity, and other than human geographies, linking with effect theory, post-phenomenology, and the co-evolutionary dynamics of different organisms is another important area. And of course, a third element is what I would refer to as the neo-Lefebvrean challenge in terms of scale-based debates and the work that Neil Brenner, Kristen Schmidt, and others have developed over a number of years. We might return to that perhaps in our discussion. The question of urban epidemiology also only really beginning to be a sustained focus of attention within urban political ecology work, with wider implications for the periodization and conceptualization of global environmental change. So to give a quick example, the Ebola outbreak of 2016, sometimes discussed in terms of a shift from a rural to an urban epidemiological dynamic. What does this mean precisely? Is this an oversimplification of a multi-scalar set of processes? And what can urban political ecology bring to this analytical field? Another area concerns eco-criticism and urban ecological imaginaries. And I would suggest that urban political ecology has tended to have a rather weakly developed engagement with aspects of aesthetics and cultural theory. And then perhaps a final point of tension and potential further development is in the methodological field and the way in which urban political ecology ought to respond to the challenge of neo-vitalism and new materialisms. What is the distinctive contribution that an urban political ecology perspective can give to these emerging methodological and philosophical debates? And then finally, and I hope I'm doing okay for time, the fourth arena, as it were, intellectually, that I've been thinking about is the ecological pluriverse. And a couple of elements to highlight here. One is the question of the re-enchantment of urban space through a different kind of set of relations with non-human others. And in terms of developing this particular perspective, I've been interested in looking at cinema and literature, as well as critical animal studies. So the film Wild from Nicolette Krebitz, set in Halle in East Germany, we're discussing and exploring the relationship between a wolf and a young woman who lives in an urban housing estate. So this question then of the re-enchantment and reconnection with nature that Jennifer Walsh wrote about so eloquently back in the mid-90s with her essay, Zoopolis. And then linked to this question of re-enchantment and rethinking relations to nature, the question of urban denizens and what kind of status non-human others have within urban space. And in that respect, we might consider the rights of nature to the city, inverting the Lefebvrean formulation. And I was fascinated by this campaign on the Paris Metro to protect rats, to stop poisoning them, to leave them alone, to simply accept them as part of urban ecology. And this question of ethics, acceptance, and the non-human other, of course, has wider ramifications for what the historian Chris Otter refers to as the zoo technosphere. And the wider implications of dietary meatification, if I can borrow that word from Neil's recent article, and I think that we'll hear more about that in a moment. Also in terms of this question then of the ecological pluriverse, the implications for urban policy and landscape design, so multifarious possibilities here. In terms of design, for a long while, I've been very interested in the work of Gilles Clément in terms of design of public parks and incorporating aspects of wild or spontaneous nature within contemporary park design. In architecture, we hear about animal-aided design, but we also hear some more complex and in some ways problematic strands in terms of tensions between generic ecologies and socio-ecological specificities. And we see this very clearly where certain aspects of landscape or architectural design are moved between different locations, sometimes with disastrous epidemiological consequences. And as a kind of a final illustration then of this notion of the ecological pluriverse, the possibility to enlist nature in terms of a spectrum of sentinel species to contribute towards forensic ecologies. So that there's very interesting work by anthropologists, such as Frederick Keck, in terms of the monitoring of the avian flu virus, H5N1 and other strands, through the monitoring of migratory birds and the intersection between wetland ecosystems, forms of industrialized agriculture and metropolitan areas. So new and complex methodological and analytical questions emerging. So to conclude then, just a few questions that came to my mind. A first question, can we build a conceptual synthesis from urban political ecology and other approaches? In particular, in terms of the fields I've been talking about, can we link urban political ecology with observational paradigms and the ecological pluriverse? Does that become a robust conceptual synthesis that is useful for us? And secondly, and perhaps related to that, I mentioned that the systems-based approaches are almost completely dominant across urban and environmental degree programs and other fields. How can we challenge this dominance within degree programs and professional practice? What kind of analytical or conceptual approaches have resonance within the academy and also within public culture? Thirdly, in the context of new and emerging diseases, what are the prospects for decisive contributions from urban political ecology and allied fields? And I was interested to read the recent paper by Neil and Swanab calling for a heterodox synthesis in relation to political ecologies of emergent infectious disease. I'm not quite sure whether this heterodox synthesis is quite the same as my notion of a conceptual synthesis, but that might be something to discuss. But I note also that they mention, in terms of scale, the need to move from the microbiological to the planetary scale. And one question I would throw out there is, what is the conceptual relationship between the microbiological scale and what's been referred to as the multi-species virosphere? Are we talking about the same things here, complementary, or possibly ideas in tension to some degree? And then my final point would be the question of a tension, as I would see it, between elements of methodological globalism and the socio-ecological specificities of urban space, which I would see as a kind of analytical and methodological tension. And again, perhaps referring back to the recent paper by Neil and Swanab, I would be interested to hear more about what they mean by the term non-city spaces, which might be something that we return to later. So thanks very much.
Thank you very much for this wonderful presentation, Matthew. Yes, I invite Mindy to join us.
Okay. And sorry, of course, there we go. Okay, I think the slides are okay for everyone now. So, well, let me start by thanking you for the invitation to join. It's really quite an honor to be here. And I also first want to really quickly situate myself in this topic by saying that before I became a sociologist and was, began studying development sociology, my PhD, I was an agronomist and I grew up in a small farming town in Nebraska. And as I was studying political economy and reading social theory for the first time, it was really through pigs and pig farming that I was able to start to make sense of some of these theories. So pigs, pig agriculture, and the Midwest, as it were, have been important grounding places for me in my work for many, many years. And I think you can see that come through in what I'll talk about today. So I want to begin my talk with the CAFO. Maybe this is very familiar to most of you. Maybe it's new or not so familiar. The CAFO is the confined or sometimes the concentrated animal feeding operation. And CAFOs are really the modern industrial technology for livestock production. The FAO estimates that as many as 80% of the livestock in the world today spend all or part of their lives in confinement. And although pigs are my focus, CAFOs are also dominant for chicken and cattle production. So I took this photo inside of a CAFO in Northwest Iowa in 1999. The farm operator here was a multi-generation settler farmer in Iowa who'd recently contracted with a pork integrator to expand. And this was a survival strategy for his family to keep farming. They took on $1 million debt to build, stock, and operate the CAFO, and they essentially became employees on their own farm, having to then follow the mandates of the contracting firm. This slide, I did not take the photo. This is an aerial photo of a group of CAFOs in North Carolina, which is the second largest hog and pork producing state in the United States, behind Iowa. And what you see here are several CAFO buildings and manure lagoons. And I'll use this photo to visualize the typical stocking rates for CAFOs. So a single building here typically holds 2,500 pigs that weigh 55 pounds or more, or 1,000 pigs that weigh less than 55 pounds. I think I actually have that backwards. In any case, thousands of pigs in each of these buildings that each on average eat 6 to 9 pounds of feed per day, and they live for about 6 months. They also excrete 10 pounds of manure each day, or 1.5 tons of manure on average per pig per year. What that means is on the average US pig farm, which has around 10,000 pigs, that's 100,000 pounds of manure a day produced, or 15,000 tons of manure produced a year on a single operation. I also didn't take this photo of Yangxiang. Yangxiang is one of the largest pig and pork producers in China and also in the world. It's famous for its pig hotels located in the mountain of Guangxi province, and I will return to this. I wanted to start with the CAFO because this technology and the processes and materials that underlie it encapsulates ongoing attempts to override the porcine body as a barrier to capital accumulation. And I say that these are attempts to override the body because although industrial livestock production has brought astronomical increases in meat production and meat consumption in the past 7 decades or so, it's also brought a host of pressing socio-ecological crises, which I think most of us are familiar with. For one thing, CAFOs necessitate and propel metabolic transformations in how much, and in what social relations livestock and people eat. CAFOs housing billions of livestock can only operate because vast swaths of the planet are transformed into soy and maize rotational monocultures. For another, CAFOs pollute bodies of land, water, and people. For another, CAFOs and CAFO metabolism are important climate change contributors. In my work, I argue that to get a hold of these massive scale transformations and contradictions for analysis, we should start with the body of the pig. We should try to understand how, as living things, pigs kept in industrial livestock operations challenge attempts at standardizing and stocking them. We should look at how industrial hogs are made and unmade, how they express global metabolic transformations and contradictions, how they continue to be utterly biological beings despite attempts to render them mechanical. Even before birth, the industrial hog must be made. Desirable traits must be genetically selected and amplified through university and corporate breeding programs that rely on the commodification of animal genetics and semen and the artificial insemination of prize sows. The industrial hog lives in the cramped quarters of the CAFO, packed tail to snout with thousands of genetically identical others. He must convert maize and soy-based feedstuffs into lean meat, even though he barely moves a muscle in his short life. He must stay healthy. He must remain standing till the end. And despite these concerted efforts to breed the animal out of the industrial hog, the lively body and the animal nature of the pig remain. Indeed, the field and the practice of swine management are largely attempts to control these bodies and natures and to override their vulnerabilities, to standardize bodies for efficient production and slaughter, to discipline bodies as predictable and profitable meat-making machines, to separate bodies from their biologies as much as possible while still getting them to their shelf life in the grocery store. But the lively body resists. An inconvenience for capital, the pig is alive and the pig sometimes dies. Not by the bolt gun at the abattoir, but from illness, disease, exhaustion. Even the highly selected hog, made through commodified genetics and breeding programs, can never fully become stock, the live part of livestock remains. In Polanyian terms, livestock are fictitious commodities. They are animals, and animals are not produced for sale. Commodities don't poop. Commodities don't get sick. Commodities don't feel anxiety, and commodities don't die. Yet in the CAFO, pigs are precisely produced for sale. They're produced as breeding stock and as commodity meat. In this process, the fiction of their commodity form is revealed in their life and in their death, when they breathe, eat, poop, ail, respond, emote, and when they die. So for several years now, I've worked on the industrialization of pig and pork production in China's reform era, that is the era from the late 1970s. And I've tried to analyze the metabolic transformations and, building on Marx and others, the metabolic rifts that underlie feeding China's pigs. Since 1979, pork has been the most produced and consumed meat in the world directly because of China. Or more specifically, the reforms to China's economy that started in 1978 that severely liberalized and privatized agriculture and other sectors. With this and state and private investment, we see an initiation of a decades-long process of industrialization in agriculture. So through the 2000s, China became home to half of the pigs in the world, and a new market that contributed to the spread of soy production in the southern cone of South America and trade-related growth and disputes. As industrial production has grown and the number and scale of CAFOs in China has increased, so too have the crises and contradictions of this form of production. I took this photo in 2010 outside of a CAFO in Sichuan province, where untreated manure and urine were dumped into the surrounding waterways. And here algae blooms on the surface from the excess nitrogen and phosphorus, making the water below eutrophic and difficult or impossible for fish and other aquatic life to survive. The stream is not an anomaly. Pollution from industrial livestock, mostly pigs and also chickens, is the number one source of water pollution in China. This manure pollution is an environmental injustice, and it's a form of fast and slow violence that disproportionately affects already marginalized people who depend on polluted water for household and agricultural use. And this is a photo from the China Daily newspaper. Now, the defecating hog as an individual, and especially in the aggregate of the industrial herd, embodies a global metabolic rift. Brazil and the United States are seasonally complementary suppliers of soy to China, given their positions in the North and South hemispheres. Landscapes in both regions have been transformed to feed China's pigs, either directly or indirectly, leaving the soil degraded, the water polluted from agricultural runoff, and food and agricultural systems oriented to industrial export production. Meanwhile, the nutrients from the soil and plants grown in the US and Brazil and elsewhere end up clogging rivers, streams, and deltas in China after making their way through the digestive tracts of the industrial hog. Nutrients that leave Iowa and Mato Grosso in this way will never return to those soils. This is a global scale rupture, a rift that first connected and then separated the countrysides of North and South America and East Asia, degrading and unevenly marginalizing places and people along the way. The solution for the billions of tons of manure produced from CAFOs is to spread it on agricultural fields. The amount of manure, however, is always more than what fields in the vicinity of CAFOs can absorb. Runoff and pollution of soil and water and of people who live on or near land is an ongoing and serious problem. In the past few years, I've become more interested in and concerned about the production of death in CAFOs and thinking about the living and dying pig. And for this, I want to return to Yangxiang in Guangxi province. This operation has gotten a lot of press, not only in the pork industry magazines that I follow, but also in the more popular press, with Reuters even running stories about this operation. These so-called pig hotels are the darlings of the industry and the nightmare of concerned publics. And the Yangxiang campus includes the tallest pig buildings in the world. I want to briefly walk through this campus. This is another view of the same operation in Guangxi from a different view. So what we see here in the back, this is a feed mill that supplies the feed that's needed to feed the pigs here on the campus. And that's its annual capacity, 85,000 tons. The feed is piped underground through pipes into the buildings that house the pigs. What we see here in front are seven-story buildings that each, that this building of seven stories holds 7,000 pigs. There's 1,000 pigs on each level of the so-called pig hotel. There are two of these on the campus, so that's 14,000 pigs. Also on this campus are nine-story pig buildings that have 9,000 pigs in each of those buildings. There are two of those, so that's 18,000 pigs on this site. Coming soon to this campus is a 13-story building, which will hold 13,000 pigs. There will be two of those, so that's 26,000 pigs. This is an awful lot of pigs concentrated on a very small piece of land. Here in the front, this building that's actually much shorter than the pig hotels, this is where workers stay. Because of the genetic uniformity of these animals, they get sick and the whole herd can be wiped out, or much of the herd can be wiped out very quickly when disease-causing organisms are introduced into the production systems. So workers need to live on site. They're not allowed to leave the production site because they may bring in viruses, bacteria, other disease-causing agents. So workers live here usually 11 months out of the year. They may leave at spring festival, especially to go see their families. When they come back, they need to stay in quarantine for a month. So the current numbers here, I don't have the current number of workers, I have the current number of sows. There are 32,000 sows currently on this campus, with the goal for 2024 to increase to 58,000 sows. Now we return here again to this beautiful view. Again, it's the same campus, just to show you where these pigs are located and where the new pigs will be coming. What we don't see in this beautiful view is the manure lagoon. This photo shows the lagoon under construction in 2018. I imagine that it's finished by now, but the point is that when this photo was taken, Yangshan was already operational. So we can make some conclusions about how strict or not the firm is in terms of manure management. More to the point with Yangshan is I want to talk about production numbers and the production of death. So this is from the company's white documents that you can get access to about their production goals. Again, the current number of sows, 32,000, the goal, 58,000 in 2024. The company's goal in 2024 is to produce 30 piglets per sow per year. The goal for how many piglets get to slaughter is 28 pigs per sow per year. Okay, so the goal for production in 2024 is 1.6 million pigs to get to slaughter. But that goal assumes that 116,000 dead bodies will be produced every year. In other words, for industries, for pork production industries, production goals and slaughter goals are different numbers because of the number of pigs that are known to never make it to slaughter, that die in the process of production. Now, I want to be very clear that this is not unique to China. Industry standards for mortality rates are anywhere between 10 and 15%. And that applies to CAFOs that operate in China, in the United States, in the UK, in the Netherlands, anywhere we have industrial livestock production. And it applies to single-story CAFOs, the conventional CAFOs, as much as it applies to pig hotels. So this everydayness of death in CAFO production is every day, that occurs every day. It's just part of the production, right? This is death that's not planned. It's death that's not wanted. It's death that doesn't result in a pork chop. It's death that is not commodified. It's death that happens because livestock are alive. They get sick from bacteria and viruses that spread rapidly among genetically uniform animals. They become lame for unknown reasons. They die from the harsh conditions of the CAFO. In addition to everyday death, again, that's 10 to 15% of an industrial herd, there's pandemic death. Before COVID in 2018 and 2019, a particularly virulent strain of African swine fever swept across China, producing 300 million dead pigs. Now, many of those pigs succumbed to the disease itself, but even more were preemptively culled to protect breeding stocks and large-scale operations. So that was 300 million dead pigs on top of the millions of pigs that die from the everyday of the CAFO. What happens to all of this flesh and bone? How is rampant, unplanned livestock death disposed? Given the everydayness of death, different countries have different regulations on disposing carcasses. In the United States, the standard procedure is to dump dead pigs into concrete pits, to liquefy their carcasses, and to spread that liquid through center pivot irrigation. Now, the nutrients, heavy metals, and antibiotics from the pig's body remain in this posthumous liquid. And this comes on top of the manure that is also pumped through center pivot irrigation to return it back to the soil. So I want to better understand the production and the disposal of death in industrial livestock, the materiality of it. I want to understand where the bodies go, how do they continue to haunt the landscape, and how do they unevenly affect marginalized, already marginalized, and newly marginalized groups of people. I want to understand this contradiction, how death is produced without an outlet or value, and how disposing death further degrades the conditions of production and life. I want to understand how the disposal of death in the CAFO shapes production practices and metabolisms, perhaps thinking about metabolic death rifts, though I think that term sounds more like a heavy metal band, so I think I might need to rethink that name. But the point being that there's a metabolic rift not only in life, but also in death, and how might we think about that? So I end here just giving reference to some of the work that I've done related to this topic, academic work and also work that's more for popular outlets, and also to end with an invitation to please be in touch if this is something you would like to think through together and continue the conversation. So I'll end there and thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Mindy, for this thought-provoking presentation. We have some time now for questions. Neil and I have plenty of questions for Mindy and Matthew. I'm going to start with a question about what I see as a divergent yet complementary movement in your works, if we think about them comparatively. So in Mindy's works, we see this like a critique of homogeneity and homogenization, right? Like the commodification of life and genetics, the production of standardized bodies, and the separation and the attempts to separate them from their biologies. And we may also assume a loss of biodiversity. Whereas Matthew's work sheds light on the contrary onto the biodiversity of cities, right? On how a more granular approach to urban ecologies can reveal this very rich ecological pluriverses. So I wanted to ask you how to understand this dynamic between homogenization and heterogeneity that a comparative gaze at your works brings to the fore. And how do you see your work in relation to each other? Wants to go first.
So you're asking about the relationship between homogenization and heterogeneity.
Yes, exactly. As a way of inviting like a comparative approach is how to put your work side by side and to comment on this different movements that are critical gazes allow us to see.
I mean, since there's hesitation, maybe I'll add a little additional comment. First of all, thanks to you both for really, provocative presentations. And And it's, for me personally, it's amazing to hear you in the same room, even though it's a Zoom room, just because I read both of your work very closely and I see all kinds of connections. And so in a certain way, I'm on the same track as Victoria. Like, you know, in a certain way, Mindy fits under the rubric, at least officially, of rural sociology. I mean, it's development sociology, but you study the rural. I mean, Mindy's written a very influential paper called Wasting the Rural, which is kind of, in a certain way, the rural is in quotation marks in your work, because you're looking at the ways in which the instrumentalization, commodification, capitalization of the non-human world is kind of constitutive to contemporary neoliberal capitalism. So in a certain way, I read your work, among many other things, as really inviting us to supersede all kinds of dualisms that underpin, you know, lots of literatures that we all work in. And similarly, Matthew, I mean, for so long, you know, you're obviously based on the urban side of that dualism. But at the same time, like your work, going back to your first book, all the way up to your most recent book, and I'm sure you're just knowing you, your present work, you're inviting us to a much more open understanding of the urban and of urbanization that supersedes, that includes, yet also supersedes the kind of more bounded and of course human-centric understanding of the city that continues to define a variety of different research fields, including systems ecology and many others. So in a certain way, again, I'm just kind of building upon Victoria's opening question, but just inviting you both to reflect upon the urgency in your work and more generally of superseding some of the dualisms, the underlying ontologies that really constrain our ability to understand the kinds of questions that you're posing.
I mean, maybe if I could just quickly comment on this homogeneity, heterogeneity question, which is a very interesting question because it can go in many different directions. I mean, when I was preparing this recent work on urban nature, I became drawn towards the question of food more than I expected, partly through the history of abattoirs, for instance, mechanized food production, but also the ethical aspect that when you start thinking about urban denizens and the right of animals to the city, then you get into the realm of context-specific animal ethics. You know, when is an animal a cherished pet, a stray, or unseen within one of these industrialized food production facilities that Mindy was talking about? So that's one element. I think also on the question of homogeneity and heterogeneity, I'm naturally drawn towards complexity and sort of fine-grained perspectives, partly through my own interest in botany, entomology, and so on, that everywhere seems very complicated to me. That so I have a natural sense of being drawn to that, as much as I like some of the larger theoretical frameworks, which are in their own way very seductive, almost intellectually. Nevertheless, I have a sense of doubt about how much we can really understand or explain sometimes. So that I feel that I'm kind of struggling with this tension between simplicity and complexity, both in terms of analysis and methodology, but sometimes also in writing as well, and trying to articulate an argument and try to think about who am I speaking to? Why is this important? What is it I'm trying to communicate?
Yeah. I mean, the thing that seems important to me in your question is thinking about these processes of homogenization and how vulnerable they are, how much effort has to be put into maintaining this never achieved homogenization. These simplifications are attempted processes that never actually work, right? And so however we want to think about the pig in my case, or the animal, or the non-human, there is some sort of rebellion, let's say, and I don't mean that in a political sense. I don't tend to think of the more than human in an anthropomorphic sense, but there is a rebellion. Want to be these three breeds. They just don't want to be. Their bodies do not want to be simplified in that way. So it's this temporary state that requires so much labor and energy and resources to try to maintain this false state.
Perfect. So I just want to invite our audience to go ahead and start adding questions to the chat. I see that a question has immediately appeared. I was going to go ahead and ask another question of my own, but I actually think if it's okay with everyone, let's turn it over to the audience and bring our group in. And I'll go ahead and read out Evan Carver's question. Evan is a colleague in the Urban Environmental Studies program at University of Chicago. So thank you, Evan. I'm going to read that out, but again, just for others who would like to ask a question, please plug it into the chat and Victoria and I will field those questions for our guests. So from Evan Carver, factory pigs and wild boars are the same species, a point elaborated at length in Thomas Fleischmann's excellent Communist Pigs. The former are a commodity, the latter are often understood as pests. Mindy, to what extent are wild boars a complicating factor in China's attempts to homogenize and commodify such large numbers of lively creatures? Matthew, are there similar examples from your work, those cute rats in the Paris metro, of phenotypic variability in a single species that results in dramatically different relationships to humans? And I'll just mention Matthew, we didn't mention this in the opening, but Matthew has a short book on moths somewhere in the mix of his many publications. I'm not sure if that might also be relevant to this particular puzzle. Thank you, Evan. Mindy, do you wanna go first and then we'll ask Matthew to respond?
Sure. So I don't think wild boars are a complicating factor in China, but what the industry would see as a complicating factor are the diversity of what we might call indigenous pig breeds in China. So China is one of the sites of kind of original domestication of wild boars. And through all these millennia of people breeding pigs in very particular environments, there's a range of different kinds of pigs that are really locally adapted all over China. And some smallholders, still are raising pigs that are not the modern breeds, that are more, you know, the ancestor or the are related to these indigenous ancestors. And so the industry sees this as a big challenge, because what the industry would like, and in many cases what the state would like, is to get rid of kind of these, you know, backwards peasant pigs and have all modern hogs. But smallholders and some medium scale farmers, you know, are using these indigenous pigs, which, by the way, are the source of some of the best genetics for the modern hog. So it's all, of course, very complicated in terms of how these genes have moved across the world in different times and at different places and for different purposes. But indeed, those kind of peasant pigs are seen as dirtying the water for the industrial hog.
Matthew.
Sure. Yeah, very interesting question. Phenotypic variability, it's such a complicated field, because you have questions of epigenetics, the accelerated evolutionary pathways that are now quite widely described in urban areas, including moths, interestingly, in industrial cities as part of the wider discourse of evolutionary change. But I think from a question of conceptualizing nature, there are some interesting things here. I think one is the difference between the individual and the population, and some recent work in terms of animal ethology, Aditya Sinha, my colleague Man Brewer and others, looking at the way that, for example, macaques, monkeys adapted to urban spaces, have specific identifiable differences in terms of personalities, particular troops adopt different ways of organizing themselves or responding to urban space. So we're way beyond, if you like, the simple category of population, something much more complex. But on this question of epigenetics and urban evolutionary pathways, one thing that has I find slightly concerning in terms of the wider implications of looking at nature as malleable and adaptable, in the sense that it can feed into certain kinds of resilience discourse. And also, I think, it unsettles aspects of biodiversity discourse, the notion that species come and go, they're constantly in a state of flux and change. And there are some interesting arguments emerging now, which from my perspective are really challenging existing conceptions within conservation biology. So the urban arena itself is becoming an area of a biological contestation in a really interesting way, I think.
Thank you very much, Matthew and Mindy. Yeah, I wanted to ask a follow-up question on that, and more specifically about what do we talk about when we talk about animals, right? Both in the livestock facilities and urban animals. And Matthew was talking a few minutes ago about animal ethics and animal rights, which is also like a strong aspect of Mindy's work. So when we think about empathy, right? It's so much easier, as Ursula Heise says, for example, to establish some form of empathy for example, cute animals perceived as cute, large mammals, and we could add farm animals or pigs, why not, right? Heise talks about that in the case of endangered species. But if you go to urban animals, I was intrigued by Matthew's example of the rats, and you also talk about mosquitoes, right, in your book, and we could add cockroaches and insects that would produce disgust and that would generate a push for their extermination. It's harder to make the case for empathy. I mean, in the flyer show us, there's this cute photo of a rat, but we know that many times that's not the case. So if we go back to, you know, some kind of a biopolitics of the non-human, how do you see the status of animals and more broadly, a general awareness about the maintenance of life or not in these two cases, and considering the possibilities they generate or do not generate of producing some form of awareness and empathy?
Maybe if I just quickly respond to that question about the biopolitical. I've been interested in trying to elaborate what I would refer to as an affirmative biopolitical paradigm. And by that, it means that I acknowledge that human intentionality is in play in relation to non-human others, whether that's selectively weeding a garden, let's say, or using control measures against mosquitoes. And of course, in the context of the COVID-19 pandemic viruses as well as living organisms. So I think that it's philosophically very difficult to maintain this notion of not doing anything in relation to non-human others. I just see that argument gets very difficult. I mean, I think that you can make an argument for ecological flourishing in terms of the health of ecosystems, but in the context of actually making strategic interventions, I think that's all around us. And that's why I've used this expression, an affirmative biopolitical paradigm. On the ethics side, I think that it's very interesting to me the way that the ethical boundaries shift. They're not fixed. As I mentioned earlier, there's a context specific dimension, which is very interesting to me. And also, I think we need to try to think outside the Eurocentric zone. I mean, very interesting work on strays or feral animals in Indian cities, for example, suggests a whole other set of relationships and different hierarchies of connection with non-human others. So I think we need to be alert to these complexities and to use our, if you like, our research imagination to move beyond what we think we know or understand already.
Mindy, do you want to respond on any of those points? I think you're muted at the moment, sorry.
I do. What I tend to think about with this kind of question, especially in the realm where I think most about this industrial production, is that it seems to me in many cases, it's easier for us to extend empathy to animals like pigs or chickens than it is for many people to extend empathy to the human others, the humans that have been othered that work in these industrial facilities. So I think of the work of Carrie Freshour, who has written, and I think she has a book in the works on her research where she worked in a chicken processing factory in Georgia among mostly Black workers and Latinx workers, and is writing about, you know, the appalling conditions there and the politics of those conditions, which we can counterpose to where we see movement in, let's say, regulations for industrial livestock. It's often around animal welfare concerns for crate sizes and things like this, but not so much about the human labor. So, I mean, I think humans are animals too. I think there's big differences, of course, but I'm really interested in the way that it can be easier for us to care about pandas and pigs than it is for us to care about groups of people who have been othered and are exploited in the process.
Thank you very much indeed, Matthew and Mindy. So we now have a bunch of very provocative questions coming from the chat. And I'm going to, what I propose to do is I'm going to read the next four. So Matthew and Mindy, sorry, we're going to ask you to work pretty hard here. You if you want to take notes or whatever, but basically we invite you simply, I'll read them out, and we invite you simply to respond to any of them as you see fit, whatever you prefer. Obviously there's no way to respond to them all. But let me just share. The first one is from our friend and comrade, Raj Patel, who's a very important scholar of capitalist agriculture. Raj, delighted that you're with us today. And Raj asked the following: thank you for a lovely juxtaposition of fantastic talks, which prompt me to ask how we might speak of the similarities between cities for pigs and cities for fat cats. Given the colonial project behind industrial soy and its systems, I'm wondering whether languages of indigeneity and decolonization can help enrich a discussion of death in the city. So that's from Raj Patel. The next question is from Johnny Bunning, who asks, how useful is a Polanyian framing in analyzing contemporary or indeed historic capitalist agriculture? It strikes me that all commodities are fictitious in their own way, and that the attempt to draw a binary between real or legitimate commodities and those not is always itself bound to fail, relying on a moral claim recycled as a state of the world, humanist in Polanyi's case, less so in animal studies. Surely pig death itself is no serious limit to commodification, and indeed can be and has been incorporated into business planning. Would not a language of tolerances be more helpful? It moves across statistical and moral domains. Surely a 70% death rate is intolerable for profit, just as a single death might be intolerable for a vegetarian. Fiction or indeed resistance here seems like an odd framing. Okay, two more questions, if I may. The next is from Paige Brand. Glad to have you with us, Paige. Paige is a student in our programs. Mindy, is your view that the making of the pigs is that the making of the pigs imply the attempt to ensure their status as non-living, while their unmaking of unplanned death is the rebellion of this? If so, how does the treatment of livestock through the effort and cost of maintaining their life complicate the industry's potential attempt to make the pig something which was not living? Similarly for Matthew, regarding the spaces of ruin and death, which are turned into biodiverse areas of urban flora and fauna, how do you see the relation of the living and non-living making its way into the pluriverse? Thank you, Paige. And then one more question from New. Hello, thank you so much for this talk. Mindy, I'm a PhD candidate hoping to write a history of the global pig, which, as you know, is also a story of the Chinese pig. So you are one of, if not the greatest scholarly inspirations for me. In your talk, you depicted the pig body as biological resistant to mechanization, and yet pigs were domesticated in China as part of the, dare I say, Malthusian political ecology of increasing population density on decreasing land, only with an intensive vegetable-based agriculture and with abundant labor and scarce land. Did domesticating a shit machine make sense or sense? In the 1930s, John S. Buck predicted Chinese and American modes of agriculture would come to resemble each other as technological transfusion and land scarcity progressed. From this perspective, might the land scarcity that currently causes so many problems for the CAFO be seen not as a problem of capitalist commodification, but rather of Western expansion running up against an ancient problem of land. So thank you very much to our audience. These are extremely challenging, sophisticated, wide-ranging questions. And Mindy in particular, I think, has her work cut out for her because a number of those questions are directed to you. So just to give you another moment to collect your thoughts, Matthew, would it be all right to ask you to go first? There's also a lot there for you to work with as well, I would imagine.
Sure. I'll have a go at a couple of these things. I mean, I caught from Raj's question something about fat cats, and I wasn't quite sure whether that's literally fat cats or anyway, the question of cats crossed my mind because in the wake of the SARS epidemic, and there was confusion about the in-between species, and there was talk of the civet cat, and a lot of cats were actually attacked in some cities because they were perceived to be dangerous. So there was a targeting of cats, and of course there's the Robert Darnton essay, "The Great Cat Massacre," as an early political tremor before the French Revolution, one of these great historical essays. The question of different commodities, I would just simply mention that there's very interesting work now on living labor in the production of commodities. For example, plants contributing as living labor to the production of commodified landscapes and parks and cities and so on. So an expanded conception of labor posing all sorts of interesting questions about how the modern city functions. And then there was a question about the spaces of ruin, the living and the dead in relation to biodiversity. And one particular interest of mine is saproxylic ecologies. These are ecologies of dead and dying trees, veteran trees, which have a very complicated status within urban space because people are scared that they're going to fall on people, but they harbor hundreds of interesting invertebrates. So there's always an ongoing interesting discussion about these very old trees. And I've done some ecological research myself on these urban trees, which I found very fascinating.
Thank you very much, Matthew. Mindy, do you want to have a go at any or all of the challenging ones that were posed a moment ago from the audience?
Yes. Okay, so to Neo, it seems to me that kind of at the heart of your question is a question of if animals should or can ever be domesticated, or if, yeah, maybe that's just it, that seems to be your question, and maybe I'm misreading you. But of course, I don't think it's that we can maybe have a single causal factor, like it's just capitalist commodification. Of course, there's other processes that precede capitalist commodification, that continue with capitalist commodification, that will outlive capitalist commodification. And I would never say that there's, you know, we can just call this one thing that is the source of all all evils or all problems in the world. So I guess this is maybe not giving you a very satisfactory answer, but yeah, I think what you bring up makes sense to also include in this longer history of, you know, these moves to domesticate animals to, as you say, what do you say, these shit domesticating a shit machine, if it makes sense. I mean, it makes sense in a way for agriculture if you can corral that shit and use it as fertilizer for crops, but as you say, that has these population implications. So I'm not doing a very good job of answering this question other than just to say that I think you're right to also be asking these questions that are bigger and longer than capitalism. And then to Paige's question, so I think I'm not trying to say that the making of the pigs is trying to get them to the status of non-living as much as I'm saying it's trying to make these bodies predictable and disciplined and controllable and standardized, and that effort is a massive effort, right? It's this effort that takes all of this capital and research and labor and resources to keep this, as I said earlier, this kind of really unstable state, to keep it in that state. So I wouldn't say that it's about making non-living things. And if the death is a rebellion, this unplanned death, is it a rebellion? Or I think I was thinking of it as sort of revealing the fallacy of being able to maintain that state, being able to maintain that state of control over these bodies. To the question of Polanyi, if it's useful or not, it sounds to you that it is not useful, which I fully respect your position on that. Yeah, and we can think of all commodities as fictions, I'm sure, but I think there is something powerful by thinking about how, again, I'm sort of repeating myself now, but how difficult and how much effort it takes in order to make something like a living body into something that can be a commodity, that can be commodified. Even though if we think of the industrial hog as really this bundle of commodities, it's body parts, it's genes, everything is sort of commodified, right? But again, I'm just trying to get to the instability of that. And the death that I'm thinking of is not about, well, I mean, one way I'm thinking about the death, and I mean, these masses of dead bodies, this is a lot of flesh, right? This is a lot of mass. It's not inconsequential. It's a daily occurrence. Is also sort of thinking about this maybe second contradiction of capital, where the production itself renders the environment and the conditions of production also not stable. So that's more what I'm thinking than sort of coming up with a number for when profit doesn't make sense anymore.
Okay, so I'm gonna ask a couple questions of Matthew and Mindy. We're making y'all work hard. We really appreciate this. And let me also just invite the audience. I'm gonna go ahead and ask this question, but there's definitely time left for another round of questions from everyone in the audience. So please feel free to type your questions in the chat. So I just wanna say, one of the things I find really inspiring and generative about both Matthew and Mindy's work is that not only do their writings in different fields really illuminate processes of transformation related to capitalism and the remaking and destruction and of nature in really powerful ways, but both of our guests are, I think, really innovative theoretically. Like, they're reaching for new conceptualizations, new epistemologies. They're criticizing inherited epistemologies in order to try to understand transformations and open up really prospects for alternatives. And to me, that's really the point of theory. That's the point of critical theory. And in that sense, I view both of you, Mindy and Matthew, as really innovative critical theorists. So I have a specific question for each of you about some of your theoretical commitments, and then a more general question just as an invitation to reflect on. So first of all, Matthew, this is somewhat specific, but one that I think is really consequential. So I really appreciated your overview of the different paradigms for thinking about urban nature in this presentation and your work more generally. But I wanted to just briefly go back to the first paradigm that you mentioned, and you're obviously, and I agree with you, very critical of the kind of urban systems approach, which I very much agree with your overview and your kind of respectful appreciation of what it contributes, but also your demarcation of its limits. But I'm just wondering, why do you think, given the kind of transformations of urban life and life more generally on the earth these days, why is that paradigm so dominant in universities and beyond? And specifically, like what can we do? Like you concluded by urging us to kind of supersede it. But like, what specifically, not only epistemologically, but in terms of our work within the university, within the spheres of policy where this paradigm is so powerful, what would you recommend? I mean, not that there's one answer, but what are some of the steps that might be done to kind of critically destabilize that paradigm? And then in a similar vein for Mindy, so you're a scholar who's really engaged deeply critically and generatively with metabolic rift theory, which of course comes out of a kind of Marxian tradition of environmental studies. And in this presentation, as elsewhere in your work, you really mobilize metabolic rift theory specifically in relation to industrial agriculture and more specifically to CAFO. And I wondered, I know you've written about this elsewhere, but I just wanted to invite you to speak to it more generally. to what degree do you view some version of metabolic rift theory as productive more generally beyond the specific site of kind of, you know, industrial homogenization, industrial intensification related to animals, related to CAFOs, but more generally in relation to the kind of environmental crisis tendencies of capitalism? And the more general kind of concern behind those questions now kind of opening out is just, you know, the project that we're all engaged in this group with CEGU is related to research, but also related to pedagogy. And, you know, we're interested in thinking about how to update our approaches to a lot of these fields in relation to the training future generations of scholars. So whether related to the specific question I just posed, and by the way, I should say not only future generations of scholars, but future generations of citizens and activists, like just more generally, like how do we deal with the incredibly challenging situation that we find ourselves in? So I just wanted to invite you to offer any reflections that you might have about how we might update, even revolutionize inherited fields of study, whether related to the urban, related to the agrarian, or otherwise. We want to hear your ideas because we hope that we'll be in a position to experiment and explore along these lines. So thank you very much. I don't know who might want to go first, but feel free to take your pick among the points that were just raised. You're both so polite that I feel like I know you both have lots to say. So, but I'm not going to call on anyone. Anyone want to just take a stab?
Shall I try, Mindy? Shall I go for it? Okay. I remember being in a New York diner with students and they were shouted at for being too slow. The person said, don't choose, pick. And they were yelled at. So things have to, anyway. So I mean, on the question of the systems-based approach, I just, as I've outlined in my talk and in some recent writing, I mean, I think it's as we all know, really, it's not a systemic critique, and that it presents a kind of epistemological dead end. And when it brings together multiple perspectives, it's invariably less than the sum of its parts. And so there's a problem here. Nevertheless, it is really very, very dominant. And so how do we unsettle that kind of firmament, if you like, of an analytical approaches? And I think that one thing which really strikes me is the need to directly reflect on the scale of violence towards both nature and defenders of nature, and to start there, and also in the context of that, to follow the money in terms of who benefits from these crimes at many multiple scales. And in my recent writing, I looked at a particular example, the Khimki Forest north of Moscow, where 10 years ago there was a proposed major road. And the people who tried to prevent this road from being built through a protected area of biodiversity, and the scale of intimidation and violence meted out against people and journalists involved, and the links between the violence deep into the Russian state all the way to the top and international banking and elsewhere. And I think that when we talk about following the money, I think it's something everyone can understand. And I think it begins to very quickly get close to what it is we're really talking about.
Okay. Matthew, were you finished?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, so the metabolic rift, it is indeed something that I seem to cling to in a way and keep using. Sometimes, I'm not going to say despite myself, but yeah. So I think that there are some things that are quite useful in thinking about the metabolic rift, which also relate to your later question of how to really engage others. I think metabolic rift is something that people can very easily pick up. I use it a lot in teaching, and it always appeals to students. You can see the light bulbs go off when they think about kind of, well, you know, I have this critique of the food system, but I'm not exactly sure how to articulate it. And the metabolic rift can help them kind of think about these ruptured nutrient cycles and distance, and also bringing labor into the question. So I like it for that reason. I like what it does in inviting us to connect the rural and the urban. Marx is really looking at these two really different spaces at the time that he's looking. And I think in a way, this is this brilliant connection between looking at, you know, enclosure in the countryside and degraded soil and the import of guano to replace the soil, and then these overflowing sewage systems in the city. I think this is really appealing to me. I think it's quite brilliant to be able to look at these two different things and try to theorize how they're connected. So I also find it really productive in those reasons. And for bringing waste into the picture, which I think often in, if we think of commodity chain studies, for instance, the chain always ends at consumption and doesn't go further to waste. So I also like it for this kind of generative thinking on waste. I think there are huge problems with metabolic rift as well. One of them, I think, is that Marx and the theory and many who use it, and I fall into this trap myself sometimes, that it assumes that there is a steady state that can exist, that a steady state between whatever we call the human and whatever we call nature ever existed, that it existed before capitalism and capitalism just ruined it, or that that's even possible, right? Just so this notion of some steady state being ruptured, I think, is really incomplete and needs a lot of work. I also think that Marx and others, he didn't understand soil. We can't really blame him for that, given the time, but that's something we can do better. We can understand soil better, and not just soil, but sort of this other than human, this non-human sphere. We need to understand that and pay as much attention to that as we do to social relations of production, which, I mean, you know, we're getting a lot better at it. Our fields, there's a lot of excellent work on this. So, but it's something that still kind of remains as a problem in a lot of metabolic rift scholarship, I would say. And I also think that metabolic rift, it is too monocausal. I think, of course, capitalism is central in what we need to do and how we need to analyze, but I'm not so sure it's not the only thing, of course. And metabolic rift doesn't get us to these other things that we need to be thinking about, colonialism and structural racism and, you know, other than human beings. So, yeah, I guess I will say that I find it expedient in some ways and also problematic in others.
Thank you very much, Matthew and Minding, for these illuminating answers. We have one last concluding question from Frederick Albertson Johnson, our colleague in the history department and a key member of CEGU. And he says, thanks, Mindy and Matthew, for your fascinating talks. Greetings from Northwest Indiana, where biodiversity and fossil capitalism seem to coexist in a landscape of steel mills, oil refineries, restored wetlands, lakeside suburbs, and Superfund sites. My question is about the challenges of the planetary scale in the social sciences. How might we incorporate the disruption of the carbon cycle or biodiversity loss on a planetary scale into your accounts of pigs and cities?
Well, the first thing that comes to my mind is that I think the processes that I've been studying are part of the disruption of the carbon cycle and biodiversity loss on a planetary scale. I think, you know, it's part of the making of those big planetary processes. It's one arena of those big global processes, I would say.
Thank you. Matthew, do you have any concluding words?
Just a quick comment, if I've understood correctly. I would say that we can appreciate urban biodiversity because it's fascinating and endlessly enriching in many ways, but it doesn't compensate for loss elsewhere. So I'll be worried about an argument that saying nature's flourishing in post-industrial cities, we don't have to worry about distant, ecologically fragile ecosystems. I think we should care about both. So that the idea of cities as a safe haven for nature doesn't contradict concern with a global scale of concern.
Perfect. So we're basically out of time. I just want to take this opportunity to, first of all, thank Mindy and Matthew. And we can't see everyone in the room, but I'm going to give you a round of applause. And, you know, we can imagine the Zoom screen or maybe even a room with everyone in person giving a round of applause to our guests. Thank you for really provocative, inspiring reflections. Thanks to Victoria. Pleasure to collaborate with you as always. And, you know, this concludes basically the series of CEGU panels for the spring, but stay tuned. CEGU.info is our website. So CEGU.info, that's our temporary website. And we should have more announcements in the weeks and months ahead about our plans and also about future events that I very much believe will be planning, looking to the future. The challenges are massive, both methodologically and politically, and we can only confront them through collaborating, both in scholarship and in practice. So that's really the spirit of this work, and we'll continue with that. So thanks again, everyone. Take good care, be safe, be well, and we will hopefully see you again very soon, maybe even in person one of these days. So thanks, everyone.